Hi everyone, how are you? It's been a while since I've done a video or anything on my channel. I think last year just like really exhausted me, and I wasn't really planning on doing this, but I've just been taking the summer off of everything, off of YouTube, off of Teachers Pay Teachers for the most part. Like I've just been taking a break. Very tired, you can hear it in my voice. But I did want to stick with our monthly book wrap-up videos, and plus this month I read a book that was written by some of my friends, and I'm really excited to show you that book. Got them all here. I didn't even really do that much reading in the month of July. I read 5 books. I didn't spend all that much time reading. I've just been like resting and relaxing a lot and watching Netflix rather than reading, so I haven't been accomplishing much at all. But let me tell you about the 5 that I did read. I liked 4 of them, and then one of them was like, not really my favorite. So the first one was the one that was like, not really my favorite. This one is called Who is Maude Dixon by Alexandra Andrews, and it was one of the Amory's book club picks, and I always really love the books that she chooses. This one just like, meh. It wasn't like very enlightening in any way. So it's a thriller. She was describing it as like a literary thriller, but I think that's only true in the sense that like the characters in the books are writers. And so it's about these 2 women who are writers. One of them works for the other one, and it's kind of like has to be like a hush-hush relationship because one of the authors writes under a pseudonym, so nobody really knows who she is. And then they like go to Morocco for some book research, and things kind of spiral out of control. So even though I'm saying I didn't like love it, I read it in a day. So it's entertaining. It's the plot moves forward very quickly. Like it's something that would be good maybe if you're like going to the beach for the day and you know you just want to kind of like maybe read a whole book like in that sitting. This is probably one you could do that with. So it's a quick read. It's fun. It's just that I usually want something else also at the end once I'm done with a book. But if you kind of like just like guilty pleasure like thriller books, then this is a good one. The next one that I read was quite different. This is called Whose Names Are Unknown by Sonora Babb. And this was one of the Life's Libraries, like book of the month type things. And so I hadn't heard of this book before, but the history behind it is really, really interesting. Sonora Babb was born in 1907, in Oklahoma Territory. So maybe it wasn't even a state in 1907. I'm not sure what year it became a state. But she lived through the Great Depression, the Dust Bowl, all of that. And so she worked for like the WPA, I think, or the Farm Security Administration, one of those. I can't remember all of the details, but she wrote this book in the late 1930s, and it's about a family in Oklahoma who is living through the Dust Bowl, and then they travel west to California just to try to survive and, you know, work in the fields out there. And it's an incredible book. Like, she's an amazing writer, and it just gives you this glimpse into, you know, what it was like for these real families. And so she brought it to her editor, and the editor loved it. But right around that same time, John Steinbeck released The Grapes of Wrath, and then her editor thought these 2 books were too similar. They have a pretty similar plot and themes and everything, and so hers never got published. So it didn't get published until 2004. That's when the book finally came out, just before she died. I think she was like 98 when she died. So just as like a piece of history, this book is really interesting. It got like edged out by Steinbeck. I read The Grapes of Wrath in high school and like didn't love it, but I don't know. I should probably read it again. I don't really remember that much about it, but this one is very, very good. If you teach high school English and you usually use The Grapes of Wrath, I would recommend just checking this one out because it accomplishes a lot of the same things, but like, I think it's better. I don't know. Before I say that, I guess I need to reread Grapes of Wrath. But there's one chapter in particular that I just think is so interesting to study. Chapter 17. And this is like the mom's diary during these terrible dust storms. And so it's like April 4th. What happens April 5th, April 6th, April 7th. It goes all the way through like April 30th. And so it's only a couple of pages, but just to read about the incessant dust, I think is really, really interesting. I think I'm gonna use this chapter in a unit about like nature, because one thing that I didn't really understand until recently was how after the Civil War, all of these farmers and planters moved west onto these lands that of course already belonged to indigenous tribes. And they just tried to plant like wheat, and they dug up all the grasses and just planted, you know, the one crop and just tried to make their money on that one crop. And it ruined the landscape. And then when there was a drought and these winds came in, there was no grass to like hold the soil in place. So all of the topsoil was being blown away. So on top of this economic crisis of the Great Depression, there was also a climate crisis, and that made things just infinitely worse for these farmers in the Dust Bowl. And it also just like, it makes you really think about like the concept of debt, like when it comes to farming, like they don't get a paycheck every month. Like they just harvest their crops and then sell that and hope that that's enough to like cover all the debt that they had to take out, because they had to buy the machinery maybe to plant the crops, as like these, you know, new tractors and stuff are coming out, and the seeds, and then their food and clothing and things like that just in between harvest times, you know. And so I don't remember understanding that concept like when I learned about the Great Depression. I just think that is interesting and just something to keep in mind. So anyway, the last thing that I have to say about this one is that to me it's very obvious that Kristen Hannah read this book before she wrote The Four Winds, and so The Four Winds to me feels like a ripoff of this book, and it's just like twice as long. It's not a bad book. I didn't mind The Four Winds. I did review it on this channel, but it didn't hit me in the same way that this one did. I think The Four Winds is pretty fluffy, and this one obviously isn't. So I'd recommend this one if you want to read about the Dust Bowl and the Great Depression. The next book that I'm so excited to tell you about is Keeping the Wonder, An Educator's Guide to Magical, Engaging, and Joyful Learning by four of my good friends, Jenna Copper, Ashley Bible, Abby Gross, and Stacey Lamb. You might be seeing this one all over Instagram and Amazon maybe, and it is so good. I've, you known about this book since the beginning, and like, you know, kind of got to hear about the behind the scenes and everything, and I'm just so proud of all the hard work that they put into this. There are a lot of guest authors as well that wrote like different blurbs about their classrooms, because all four of these teachers teach high school English. And so if you do teach high school English, this is like perfect for you. But then they also got the perspectives of people who teach different grade levels and different subjects. So there's more in here than just English. But for English teachers, this is really good. But all four of these teachers just really have an emphasis on creating wonder in their classrooms, and sometimes doing that with like the room itself, and sometimes doing that with like movement within the classroom, sometimes with sound or with songs or with just like different activities that they choose in order to like make the content come alive. So if you're feeling like very burnt out on teaching like I am, especially after last year, this book is a really great one to read just for some inspiration and some excitement to get your wheels turning about next year. And one of the things that I really like too is that most of the strategies in here are just like really simple. Like there's nothing too over the top. It's really not about like entire room transformations and stuff. Like maybe you just like turn off the lights and play some, you know, fire sounds or like creepy sounds if you're reading like a a scary story or whatever, like just very simple things that just show that you've like put some thought into it, and you can kind of like create an atmosphere around a lesson and just something that will help students to engage with what you're teaching and then like remember it for a long time. So this one is awesome. I'll link all of these in my bookshop.org thing. So these will all be linked down below. The next one that I read was one that had been on my list for a while, and I just like, I finally was like, okay, I'm just gonna read this. And again, I think I read this in one day because it was that good, and also I don't do anything, so I can read a book in a day since I hardly leave the couch. So this one is Firekeeper's Daughter by Angeline Bouley. And because of the beautiful cover, I thought that it was gonna be a little bit more of like a fantasy book. So that was actually, you know, initially where I read it, I was thinking like, oh, maybe I can include this in my fantasy lit circles. But this one is actually like a mystery thriller. So it takes place in Wisconsin. It's been a little while since I read it. But the main character, Donis, she is like deeply intertwined into her community, but she also feels like an outcast. So her mother is white and their family like owns a lot of land and stuff and like owns businesses and stuff and has been in the community for a long time. And then her father was from the Ojibwe reservation nearby, and obviously they had been there for centuries, and their tribal presence is still really strong, and she's really close with like her aunt on her father's side. Her father has passed away by the time we meet Donis in this book, but she recently graduated from high school. She was a hockey player. She has a younger brother who's still a hockey player, so there's a lot of like hockey stuff in it. But there are a series of very strange murders, and people are going missing. And, you know, she knows some kids that are getting addicted to meth, and she's kind of starting to think that there are like some connections and some people kind of pulling the strings, and she wants to figure out what's going on. And so it's very fast paced. You know, you're not sure who to trust. It reminds me of a Louise Erdrich novel because of the themes and because there's so much like tribal knowledge within the book. It's just very, very well done. I think it's great for adults. Like any adult would enjoy this book. And then I think like high schoolers for sure. Like the characters are just older. You know, they've either graduated from high school or they're seniors in high school. So it's not really much of like a middle grades novel, just because the characters are dealing with like college admissions and stuff like that, you know. So I don't know that it's great for like my middle school classroom, but just overall, it's a really, really good book, and I definitely recommend it to you as an adult reader. Got all my stacks here. The last one that I read this month was The Anthropocene Reviewed by John Green. I started this a while ago and I was just kind of like savoring it. This is my favorite John Green book because I'm 35 and not 16. I have read all of his other books. I do really love The Fault in Our Stars and all of those, you know, but this one is my favorite. It is nonfiction. It's just a series of nonfiction essays reviewing different aspects of human life. And he also has a podcast where they do this as well. So I actually haven't listened to the podcast, so I don't know if like some of the chapters are kind of like repeats of some of the episodes or not, but you know, like John Green does, he'll bring up something that's just kind of like, you know, trivia, like interesting to know, and he'll teach you a little bit about it, and then he ties it all together in the end and really makes it about like the human experience in general. So he's very, very good at that. I really enjoyed each of the essays. I think like quite a few of them you could use as like a mentor text, definitely in high school, maybe also in some middle school classes. I mean, there's, you know, Plague, which was quite relevant. He wrote this, you know, during this pandemic that we've all been going through. And so, you know, it's, it reflects like what we've all been going through the past year or two. I thought the Kentucky Bluegrass chapter was really interesting. Super Mario Kart, that one was pretty funny. Harvey was a really good chapter just about mental health and depression. And in that one, he also writes about Amy Cross Rosenthal, who I didn't realize he had been friends with, but she has a book called The Encyclopedia of an Ordinary Life. And I read it like 15 years ago, and it's one of my favorites. It's quite similar to this. Like, I think if you like this, you would like this one. It's just little essays about things that she notices in her life, but they're organized a little bit more by letter. Yeah. Oh, I think I'm gonna reread this. Oh yeah, like there are a bunch of different entries under the letter C, for example, or under the letter F or whatever. So yeah, this one was really good. Like these two are both quite similar and just like, you know, nonfiction that really makes you feel something. Nonfiction that can kind of like get you through a hard time. So I think they're very much like a balm. That's how I would describe this book. So I'm excited about this one just to like keep it on my shelf and like refer back to it and even to use some of the essays in class this year. I think that'll be fun. My voice has about had it. I can't really talk anymore today at all, I don't think. It's not COVID, but I have been having some other health issues that we can just talk about in a different, more relevant video. So anyways, thank you guys for watching, and just an extra congratulations to the Keeping the Wonder crew. I'm so proud of their new book, and I think I also read this one in a day. It's really, really good. Don't forget to get your hands on it. And I don't know when I'll see you guys next, but if I'm feeling better soon, we'll do some back to school content. I don't know if I will be. So if I don't see you before we go back to school, good luck. Happy back to school. Bye guys.